Yeah, hello. So we have to continue our calculation for the kernel or the scaling which we get in the description of the largest eigenvalue. So we want to look on the distribution of the largest eigenvalue of a GUE, and we derived the formula for this, which was given for finite n in terms of the kernel, which describes the joint eigenvalue distributions. And the idea is that if we do the right scaling, then this kernel should have a limit. And so maybe let me recall what we saw last time. So what we want is that the probability in the right scaling, so with n to the 2/3, and then we take the maximal eigenvalue of the n by n matrices, and because we are calculating with the unnormalized ensemble, we have to divide here on this level by square root of n, then this largest eigenvalue should be in the neighborhood of n. And the scale where it should really live is this scale, and so this the probability that this scale thing is less than t. That's the guy of which we expect, and actually we know that this converges to something. If n goes to infinity, and this converges to the Tracy-Willems distribution. But we want, or the cumulative function of this. But we want to see how to describe this. And so we saw that we can describe this in terms of our kernel as a kind of Fredholm determinant. So this means this is a sum from 0 to n for the n by n matrices. Then we have an alternating sum divided by r factorial, and then we are integrating from t to infinity all the eigenvalues, because we want the probability less than t, which means actually we calculate the probability that there's nothing outside of t, and so we look on the probabilities that there are eigenvalues that all of that they are in from t to infinity. So we integrate over this, and we integrate our joint eigenvalue densities, which is given by a kernel, and actually because I do here the rescaling, I will get here a rescaled kernel, which I denoted by k and Twiddle, and then I have here xi, xj, I and j running from 1 to r, and I'm integrating over all the x's. So I'm let me see. So what is r? I think r is k. I'm summing here over r. And so I get for each r, I get this contribution, which is given in a determinant of an r by r matrix in my r variables over which I integrate. Good. And so we expect that this limit exists, and we expect that it exists because this kernel here has a limit in this scaling. And maybe let me. Maybe let me recall again the scaling which we did here. So this k and Twiddle of the variables x and y, this is actually some factor n to the minus 1 over 6, and then it's a kn of x and y scaled in the right way in the neighborhood of 2 square root of n. 2 square root of n is where we expect the largest eigenvalue, and then we are looking in a small neighborhood. Namely x, but scaled with n to the minus 1 over 6, and the same for y. Okay, so this is the order where we expect things to happen. And so what we want to see is that this guy has a limit if n goes to infinity, and then this formula has also a limit if n goes to infinity. And it will essentially it will be the same formula, where just we have the limit of the kn here. Good. And for this, of course, we have to look on our kn and write it in a form where we really can check that it has a limit. And the kn was given by the Hermite functions, but we were summing over all of them from 0 or 1 to n. And of course, if n goes to infinity, then I have a sum over all of them is not so good. So, but last time I showed you that actually we can rewrite this in a form which only involves the n's and the n minus first Hermite function or polynomial, yeah, and then the hope is that we can control this limit. So where we stopped last time, was that I rewrote the kn. Later we have to see about the scaling. So what we get was that the kn, we can also write in a form, so kn of xy, which a priori is a sum over all Hermit polynomials from 0 to n minus 1, that we can also write this in a form which only involves psi n and psi n minus 1. So namely the final result of the calculation from last time was we get a square root of n, and then I have a psi n of x times psi n minus 1 of y minus, and the other way around, psi n minus 1 of x psi n of y, and we have to divide by x minus y. So this was the application of this Christoffel-Dabou formula, which we did in assignments, applying this to the Hermit polynomials, and of course those guys are the functions, but they just have essentially some factors there which are not really affected by doing those calculations, and usually things fit together quite nicely. Good, okay, so here we have now something where kn only involves psi n and psi n minus 1, but it also has this factor square root of n, which still looks a little bit annoying. And maybe it's also annoying that we have psi n and psi n minus 1, because this means we should control psi n and psi n minus 1 at the same time if n goes to infinity, which might also not be so good. And for this, we continue to rewrite this, namely the psi n minus 1, we can actually replace by the derivative of the psi n. So it will be better to control psi n and the derivative of psi n instead of psi n psi n minus 1. And this is because, I mean, the psi n's, these Hermit functions, satisfy a couple of differential equations. They are related among each other. And actually, you are asked to prove this on the new assignment. Okay, so I mean, so psi n, so this Hermit function satisfies the following differential equation, which actually relates the derivative of psi n with psi n minus 1. Okay, it's not an equation just for the psi n. Later we will have one which was only for the psi n, but here we have one which is of the form the derivative of psi n. So this is minus x over 2 psi n of x plus the square root of n psi n minus 1 of x. So you ask to prove this in the new assignments. And we can now use this, and you see that here we have the square root of psi n minus 1, which is exactly what we have here, and even the square root fits very nicely. So you see, I mean, we are getting rid of the square root if I replace this here by the other things. So from this, we get then that kn xy, so I'm just plugging now in for n square root of n times psi n minus 1 of y, I'm plugging in this minus this for the y's, and here for the x in the same way. So what I get is, so the first term, the psi n of x remains, but the psi n minus 1 of y is times square root of n is now replaced by the derivative of psi n at the argument y, bringing this on the other side, is plus y over 2 psi n of y. Okay, so that's the first term, and then I'm subtracting the same thing for the x. So I have here psi n prime of x plus x over 2 psi n of x multiplied with psi n of y, and the whole thing is still divided by x minus y. Yeah, and so you see I have now essentially two types of terms, psi n times psi n prime and psi n times psi n, which is multiplied with some factors. And so if I split those, so I have the psi n of x psi n prime of y minus the same thing with x and y exchanged, so psi n of y sine prime of x. This is divided by x minus y. And then for the other term, you see I just have sine of x times sine of y. It's getting multiplied with a y, and here with a x, with a sine. So actually the x minus y in this term cancels away. And I'm just left with the 1/2. So it's minus 1/2 sine x sine y. Okay, good. So this looks now somehow better. I mean, there's now no explicit dependency on n anymore, and it's really just in psi n and psi n prime. So now we do the rescaling. So this is for the unscaled thing, but now of course what we want is the kernel k and twiddle, where we do the rescaling, and we should now see how the k twiddle term reads in this guise. So now we put, now we do the rescaling. So on the level of the psi's, this was, or we have now to decide essentially, I mean, okay, we have to rescale the argument, that's clear, but then we will also get some factor which should be the right factor to take care of all things, and I mean, this will be here n over 1/12. And then we take psi n of 2 square root of n plus x times n to the minus 1 over 6. Yeah, and of course if we do this scaling, then of course we get also a scaling for the derivative. You see we also need the derivative here. So this means if I take here the derivative, so the psi n twiddle prime at x, so this is n to the 1 over 12. Yeah, but then I get the derivative of the psi n, but I also get the inner derivative. I take the derivative with respect to x, so I also get the n to the minus 1/6. So it's times n to the minus 1 over 6, and then I get the psi n prime twiddle. But of course at this argument, 2 square root of n plus x times n to the minus 1 over 6. And of course, so this here is n to the 1 over 12, and n to the minus 1 over 6 is n to the minus 1 over 12. So this is n to the minus 1 over 12. Good, and so we can now use this and plug it in the kernel, which we had for the kn, and do the rescaling. So to get the kn twiddle. So I mean, just to take note this here, because this is our kn twiddle. Okay, so with this we have, so the kn twiddle. Maybe I just continue here. So what is this? So this is here n to the minus 1 over 6, n to the minus 1 over 6. And then I have to take this kn at those positions. So I have to take the psi n, but at those guys here. So let me see. So this is the psi n twiddle at x. But the relation between, where is it? So you see it, the psi n, I mean, the psi n twiddle is the just the rescaled, the argument is rescaled, but we have this factor. So if I replace the psi n by the psi n twiddle, I also get the n to the minus 1 over 12 on this side. So I have the psi n twiddle times n to the minus 1 over 12. And then I have the derivative. And for the derivative, you see, if I replace the derivative by the derivative of the psi n twiddle, of course I get the rescaling of the arguments, but I also get this term, which on the other side is n to the plus 1 over 12. So I get here the psi n twiddle at this argument, which is now y, but I get n to the plus 1/12. And I have to divide it by x minus y, but x minus y are now also getting rescaled. Of course, the 2 square root of n goes away, but of course, they are replaced by the n to the minus 1 over 6. So this is now getting replaced by n to the minus 1 over 6 times x minus y. And you see things here fitting nicely together. But then we also get the other term, the minus term here. So I have minus 1/2. Maybe I continue here. Need a bit more space. So minus 1/2. And again, so I have the psi n twiddle. Or yeah, I have the psi n. If I replace this by the psi n twiddle, or maybe first of all I get this overall factor n to the minus 1/6. Then I'm replacing the psi n by the psi n twiddle, which gives me psi n twiddle times n to the minus 1/12. And I'm also replacing the psi n y in the same way. So this gives me the psi n twiddle y n to the minus 1/12. And the x minus 1 has gone away. There is no, so this is not divided here. So that's what I get here. And so what I get all together, you see here I have, yeah, what do I have here? I have n to the minus 6, which goes away with this, n to the minus 1/6, and here I have n to the minus 1/12, and here I have n to the plus 1/12, which goes away. So you see all the n's cancel here. I mean, that's the only reason why I really put all the n factors there, because of we want to see it, how it behaves for n going to infinity, so we really should see that it fits together nicely. And that I also have chosen the right n factor here. Because I mean, I had some freedom, essentially, what I'm doing here, but it is done in such a way that things here go away nicely. So what I have here, I just have the psi n twiddle of x times, this should be the derivative, huh? No, how is it? Let me see. What have I done here? Yeah, I mean, actually, I'm missing here also the second term. What I have done here is just taking this term, and then I should subtract this term. But in this here, of course, is also derivative. Okay, and here I get it the other way around. But there, the n factors are the same. So what I get from here is the psi n of x twiddle times the derivative of the psi n twiddle at y. And then minus the same thing the other way around. So the psi n prime of x of the twiddled version times psi n of y. This is divided by x minus y. And then I have this other term, this term here. And there you see the n's are not really going away. I get n to the minus 1/6, n to the minus 1/12, n to the minus 1/12. So this is n to the minus 1/3. Or to put it the other way, I write it as 1/(n⁻⁷). And then I have here psi n twiddle of x, psi n twiddle of y. And if n goes to infinity, then I mean this guy here. So now we should, we hope that psi n has a limit, and also psi n twiddle. This means this should go to something. So this would also go to something, but because of this term, the whole thing here goes away. So this term will disappear in the limit. And we are only left with this guy here. And that's what one really has to see. Now, I mean, the main point now is to see that those rescaled Hermite functions have a limit. And that's really something which one can show, but which I'm not going to do. So I mean, this is a steepest descent method where you have to do, so this is non-trivial. And in particular, the convergence is so strong that the derivative also converges. So one really has a very nice convergence. And the object which one gets in a limit, that is what is called the Airy function. Well, I mean, this is Airy function is a known object, but this appears in the limit. So at this level, so one can show but we are not able to do this now. So by non-trivial steepest. Descent method. That this rescaled version of the Psi-N converges to a limit. Okay, and so let us call this limit the array function, or as abbreviation AI, and then I want also to see what we expect, what the characterizing property of this array function is. So I mean, for now it's just the name which I give to this limit. So let us call it so AI. So this stands for array. So this should be the limit psi n twiddle of x if n goes to infinity. So and we call it the array function. But I mean, there exists, of course, an array function, and this is the solution of some differential equation, and maybe we should check, at least formally, what is the differential equation which we expect for the limit of this. And this is then the one of the array function. Okay, so this can also go away. Yeah, okay, so this this is the array function. So AI, name is array. Array function. And actually, so yeah, as I said, the convergence is so strong that also the derivative of the Hermite functions goes to the derivative of this function. So, I mean, those are all things which one has to show, which I'm not going to do. But it gives you some idea about the structure and the limit, such that also the derivative of the array function is actually the limit of the derivative of these rescaled Hermite functions. Okay, and then our description somehow. Yeah, then first of all, this rescaled kernel here then converges also to a kernel, which is the limit of this, which is given by the array function expression, the same kind of expression. This disappears in the limit. And this guy here has a limit where we get the formula. The same formula, where we just take the limit here. So we take the limit of this Hermite, of these rescaled Hermite kernels, and this gives us the array kernel, which will be just this guy here. Okay, so what we get is that our rescaled kernel, so the limit of k n twiddle x y. This will be, this will be the limit of this formula, and so this goes to the array function. This again, I have forgotten the derivative here. So this goes to the array function. This goes to the derivative of the array function, and here it's the other way around. And this goes to the array function, but this goes to zero, so this term disappears. So the limit of this rescaled kernel is given by this expression here, but where psi n is now replaced by the area function. So I have here the area function of x times the derivative of the area function of y minus the derivative of the area function at y times the area function at x divided by x minus y. Okay, and this guy is now, also a kernel, which is usually called the area kernel and maybe denoted by AI of XY. So this is the area kernel. Good. Okay, but of course at the moment this is just a name. So it's a limit. Of course I tell you there exists a limit. We call it the area function. But the question is, how can it be characterized? Okay, and for this, it's a limit of the Hermite functions, so it should also, maybe the Hermite functions satisfy some differential equations. So the limit of this probably also satisfies some differential equations. And maybe we should also check what this should be. Again, just on a formal level. To make this rigorous, of course, this is a bit tougher. So let us characterize on a formal level this limit function. AI. Okay, and for this we should take maybe the main differential equation for the Hermite functions. We had one before, but this was one which related psi n, the derivative of psi n with psi n minus 1. That's not what we want. We want now a differential equation just for psi n, and that's the following one. Again, something which you should prove on the assignment. So the Hermite functions psi n satisfy the following second order differential equation. So namely, if I take the second derivative of the psi n at x, then this is a multiple of psi n. So this is n plus 1 over 2 minus x squared over 4 psi n of x. This is equal to 0. So that's why the Hermite functions are so important and famous. That's the equation which they satisfy. So for example, they show up as the wave functions if you're sitting in a potential like this. Good, anyhow, so that's something which one can prove, and you will prove it. And so this means, so that's for the unscaled guys. So our psi and twiddles are scalings of this, which means the derivatives also get some n factors. So let us look what we get there. So rewrite this equation into the rescaled Hermite functions. So for the psi n twiddles, we have, so the derivative of the psi n twiddle, so the rescaling was minus 1 over 12, which we calculated before. It's not here anymore. So this was n to the minus 1 over 12 of the original one at the rescaled argument, 2 times square root of n plus x to the n minus 1 over 6. So this was because we had an overall factor here, and then we get the n to the minus 1 6 here. And now if I take the second derivative, I will get an additional n to the minus 1 over 6. So for this equation, I need the first and the second, I need the second derivative. So the psi n second derivative of x. So this is n to the minus 1 12. But then I will also get an n to the minus 1 6 for the inner derivative. And n to the minus 1 over 12 and n to the minus 1 over 6 is n to the minus 1 over 4. So this is 2 over 12. 3 over 12 is minus n to the 1 over 4, and I get the second derivative of 2 times the square root, 2 times the square root of n plus x n to the minus 1 over 6. Okay, so now I can rewrite this equation in terms of the rescaled guys. And then we get an equation for the psi n's, which formally has a limit if n goes to infinity. Of course, you see, I mean, here you still have this explicit n, which would explode if I just would send n to infinity. And I mean, those guys here don't really have a clear limit. It's only in this rescaled version that we have those nice limits. Yeah, so what do we get? So the psi n double prime twiddle of x. Yeah, so what is this? So for this, I should take n to the minus 1/4, and then I get the I bring this on the other side. So then I get the second derivative of this guy at its argument, and this is the same as this. So this is I put here the minus sign, and then I have n plus 1/2 minus x squared. But of course, the x is now rescaled, so the x is actually now 2 square root of n plus x to the n to the minus 1 over 6. Of this, I take the square divided by 4. And then I multiply this with psi n at the rescaled argument. But of course, I want to express the psi n also in the psi n twiddle. And there I get this n to the minus 1 over 12 factor times psi n twiddle of x. Okay, good. So I just have taken this equation and I replaced the psi n second derivative and the psi n by the corresponding twiddled versions here. With those, where I'm getting those arguments here. And of course, I also have to replace the x by the rescaled x. Yeah, and now I can see, what do I have here? I mean, does this guy have a limit? I mean, we know essentially that the psi n have a limit, also the first and the second derivative, so they go to something, but what is appearing with those coefficients? Of course, better that nothing should explode. I mean, some terms might go to zero, and something should survive. So let's see, what do we have here? N to the minus 1 over 4 and n to the minus 1 over 12 is again n to the minus 1 over 3. And then I have here an n plus 1 over 2. And of course, here I have the square of this, and maybe, so I have here over 4. And so if I square this, I get 4 times n. Plus 2 times, so plus 4 times the square root of n times n to the minus 1 over 6 times x plus the square of this, which is plus x squared n to the minus 1/3. N to the minus 1/3. Good. Okay, now you see I have terms which go to zero, and I have terms which survive. I mean, first of all, this factor n here, this would be bad, because this will not be cancelled by this guy. So if this would survive, then I would have problems. But you see this n here, I also have here, and it goes away. So it's really the combination which makes this term going away. And then so what is a surviving term? Let me see, n to the minus. I have here n to the minus 1/3. This together with this 1/2, so this 1/2 multiplied with this goes to zero. So this disappears. then n to the minus 1/3, and here I have n to the minus 1/3, this is also dividing by some power, this also goes to 0. Okay, but here I have the square root of n times n to the minus 1/6, and this is n to the 1/3. Okay, so this is the same order as this. So this guy here will actually survive. So the n's go away. I have here 4 over 4, which is 1, and I have here an x. So this is x. So you see that, I mean, some of the terms go away. In particular, the ones which would really be problematic, which would explode. But there's one term which survives, which is x. Okay, and the whole thing here, of course, is multiplied with this thing. So you see that what I get here in the limit is minus x times psi n twiddle of x. And so what I expect, okay, this is approximately for large n, and so what I expect for this limit function of the psi n's is this differential equation that the second derivative is minus x times the function itself. And this is actually the differential equation for the area function. So the area function is defined by as a solution of this equation. So hence we expect that the area function should satisfy this equation. And that's okay. The area function is the solution to this, so it's okay if we call this limit AI, the area function. So I mean, I took really some efforts to put the ends there so that you really see that, I mean, that we get something in the limit. I mean, this was tough work, so maybe you should also do it by yourself. Or putting the n factors there and see what survives. And that we really get in the limit, at least on this formal level, the right equation. Okay, so we expect that the area function should satisfy the differential equation that the second derivative minus or plus, I don't know, do I have a... I have here also minus sign, so here I have plus, and if I bring it on the other side, I get here minus x times the area function is 0. Okay, and so maybe let me now define the area function officially by this differential equation. But of course, such differential equations might have more than one solution. And actually, the area function is also determined by giving the asymptotics on one side. This makes it then unique. And actually, this is more or less the asymptotic which we saw in our estimates for the probabilities. Good, okay, so here is the formal definition. So the area function, so this is a function from R to R. So this is a solution of this differential equation, which is called the area differential equation. So this is a solution of the area ordinary differential equations. So let me denote the function by u. So u double prime is x times u of x. Okay, this doesn't determine it uniquely, but so we also specify the asymptotic behavior for x going to infinity. So determined by the following asymptotics. If you go to infinity, plus infinity, so namely, the area function of x should behave there asymptotically like 1 over n. I mean, there's no explicit formula for the area function. So it's in terms of other functions which we know. So pi to the minus 1/2, x to the minus 1 over 4, e to the minus 2/3 x to the power 3 over 2. And I mean, you should compare, this was somehow similar as what we get in our, what we expected of the estimate which we had for probabilities. We also had a behavior like this. So this fits somehow together. Good, okay. And I mean, that's really, so if one really shows this all rigorously, then one sees that in the limit I get exactly this function, which also has, which satisfies this differential equation and which has this asymptotic behavior. Good, okay, and then of course I can take this function and define the array kernel in the same way as I more or less already did it before. And then with this, one can then show that really all the limits go through very nicely and our probability, which we're interested in, really converges to this Fredholm determinant in terms of this array kernel. Which means I'm getting really the limit of this equation here. Where just here the array kernel shows up. Yeah, so let me also, as part of the definition, define the array kernel. So the array kernel is defined by, so this is a kernel, so depending on two arguments, and it's defined in the same way as we saw that the Hermite polynomial behaves in a limit in terms of the Hermite functions. So namely it's the array kernel of x times the derivative of the array function of y minus the other way around, the array function of x, the derivative, times the array function of y divided by x minus y. Yeah, and with all those definitions, we now really can write down the theorem, which tells us that what we have observed here formally really is rigorously true. So namely that this equation here has a limit. And I mean, the limit which we get here, that's what we call the Tracy-Widom distribution. And on this side, the limit, of course, the sum will now go to infinity. And here, we just go here to the limit, and the limit of this guy here is just the array kernel. So, theorem which summarizes in a rigorous way what we observed formally, so namely that this random variable, so namely this guy here, so the random variable, if I take the maximal eigenvalue, its difference from 2, and scale it with n to the 2/3, so I'm really looking in a small neighborhood of 2, what happens there? So this random variable of, okay, and here I'm going to the normalized one, which means I forget about this, of the normalized GUE has a limit distribution as n goes to infinity, and the cumulative distribution of this, so the probability from minus infinity up to t, this is given by the limit of this guy here. So it's limiting cumulative distribution function is, okay, maybe, continue over there. So first we give a name to it, we call it f beta, but then we get a formula, which is the limit of this formula which we had for finite n. Yeah, so this limit function is, so we call it f2 of t, 2 to indicate that this is the limit for the orthogonal, for the unitary ensemble. I mean, there are similar formulas for f1 and f4 for the symplectic and the orthogonal ensemble. But there, things are usually a bit more complicated. Okay, but so first of all, this is the limit of the probability n to the 2/3 lambda max minus 2 is less than t. Yeah, okay, so I'm not really sure why I consider it a normalized. We always did it with the unnormalized one, so maybe I should still divide it here by the square root of n. Otherwise, maybe this here is not correct. I'm not so sure. But okay, it's a limit of this, and this is given by taking the limit of this formula here. So I have maybe start with 1. This is the r equal to 0 term there. And then I'm summing from 1 up to infinity minus 1 to r divided by r factorial. Then I have these integrals from t to infinity, where essentially I'm looking of having no eigenvalues from t to infinity, and I'm integrating over a determinant of a matrix, and the entries of the matrix are given by the array kernel. So I take ai of xi xj. So this is a r by r matrix. So I'm summing over r. So for each r, I have such an r by r matrix. Take a determinant of this, and then integrate this over all the r variables which I have here. dx1 up to dxr. Good. Okay, and so this here is, in a sense, this expression here is what is called a Fredholm determinant given by this kernel. Okay, but of course this is a complicated expression. It's more a nice theoretical result that we have the limit, and it is given in terms of this array kernel. But if you really want to calculate what this function is, I mean, this is not so helpful. Okay, and so actually there's another theorem, and this is maybe the main result of Tracy and Widom, which gives you another characterization of this. So I mean, this here is essentially showing that we look on n by n matrices, we write down formulas in terms of the Fredholm determinant, rescale things in the right way, observe that our kernels have a limit, and see what this limit is, namely it's given by the array function, and then the formulas go over to the limit. Okay, but this is not really saying us that we understand the limit maybe in a good way. And there's another more, in a sense, more explicit description in terms of a different differential equation, which is maybe a main result, and which is really much more useful for doing concrete calculations. So I mean, in the assignment you are asked to look on the asymptotics of the Hermite functions to see that it's the array function. But of course, I cannot ask you numerically to calculate Tracy-Widom by this formula, because it's not really clear and it's not really doable. Okay, so there will be another characterization, which I'm writing now down. But it's also complicated, so I decided not to ask you in assignments, but maybe you should still try to do it. But for this, you would need to get some more information about the differential equation, which shows up there, which is a pain in the way equation, which is a kind of classical differential equation, but a complicated one. So maybe I'm just writing down the theorem. Which is one of the main results of Tracy and Widom from around 94. So namely this distribution f, this function f2, so the distribution function f2 satisfies the following. So it can be given, it can be written as somehow the exponential of something, but this something is again not an explicit function, but it involves another function which is given by the solution of a differential equation. Okay, so namely it is given as the exponent, and here we have minus the integral from t to infinity. Here I have x minus t, and here I have another function which I call q of x squared dx. Okay. So I mean, I said this Drese-Wilhelm function somehow should be like a normal distribution for interacting stuff. I mean, the normal distribution we could write down very easily formulas like this. For the normal distribution, we have densities. For this Drese-Wilhelm stuff, we don't have explicit formulas. It's more indirect. And so here you see I have to take the exponential of this function guy. And then this q, this is now again something which I cannot write down explicitly, but it's a solution of a differential equation. But it's a solution of a quite famous differential equation, namely a Penleve equation. And actually there are, I think, 6 Penleve equations, 1 to 6, and this is the solution of Penleve 2, which of course probably doesn't tell you much, so but I will write down this equation. So where q is the solution of the so-called Penleve 2 equation. And those, I mean, the Penleve equations are equations which were classified by Penleve beginning of 1900 or so as having a special behavior in terms of their singularities. So he looked for differential equations of, I think, second order, which have some special type of singularities, and there are 50 or so. Most of them are functions which we already know or can be expressed in terms of functions which one knows, but there were 6 of them which didn't fit into this and which we already knew, and they are called Penleve 1 up to 6. Okay, and here is one of them. So namely, it's an equation that the second derivative of x minus x times q of x, and you see this is the part which also is the Airy function, but then we have an additional term, namely 2 times q of x to the power 3. So it's a quite nonlinear thing. And so it's the solution of this, and again you have to specify somehow the boundary asymptotic behavior to make it unique. And here this guy should behave like the Airy function. The Airy function of x as x goes to infinity. Good. Okay, so I mean, maybe if you're interested, you should look up Penleve equations on the internet. So there's a lot to say about this. This is interesting, and it's not really, I mean, it's not clear why you should get here something like this. So it's really, and also, if instead of looking on the edge of your spectrum, so about the largest eigenvalue, if you're looking in a bulk and you want to consider the limit of the appropriately rescaled Hermite functions there, so which describes the fluctuations of eigenvalues in the bulk, then you get again something which is described in terms of solutions of a Penleve equation, but of a different one. And I mean, those relations are not really so closely related. So it's so I mean, there are 6 of them or so, but at least 2 of them show up very concretely for the statistics of the eigenvalues of random matrices. But one of them for the edge and one of them for the bulk. And it's just 2 independent calculations. Good. Okay, so I think I'm not going to say, I'm not really able to say more about this. And you see still it's not, I mean, you could use this for producing numerically a function of this. That's of course what one maybe should also do. I mean, you were asked to produce histograms of the largest eigenvalue, so you should see a distribution, but of course one should compare it with this guy. But for this, you would have to solve this and then of course also this. And I think, I mean, MATLAB, for example, has the Airy function there. But it doesn't have the Penleve functions there, and so you really would need to solve equations like this, which, okay, I'm not going to ask for an assignment, but maybe you should try to think a little bit about this, how really this can be done. And I mean, there are quite effective, I think, algorithms now which really allow you to produce this. But it's not a trivial thing. It's not a priori clear how to produce this function. Good, but I think that's enough on this, or are there more questions on this? Because then I would go over to the one thing which essentially is still missing for our whole derivation. So namely, at the very beginning, for the moment method, where we did our estimates for probabilities, for tail distributions, I used this result of Hara and Sagier. And I promised you that I will still prove this. And I will prove this in a combinatorial way. I mean, there are analytic approaches to this, but there's a nice combinatorial way of proving it, and this is more or less the original proof of Hara and Sagier. So that's what I want to present. I mean, that was something which we used in particular to see that the largest eigenvalue converges to 2. So, and this recursion of Hara and Sagier is a quite non-trivial one. So maybe I first recall you the statement of Hara and Sagier, and then I will prove you. So, okay, let us do a new chapter on this. So, I mean, I told you everything which I wanted to tell you about Tracy Widom. I mean, I will maybe still say a few more words about it as an application for the longest increasing subsequence. But I mean, I'm not going to talk more about the structure of Tracy Widom and how to calculate it. So that was really here the analytic part. But to close the gap for the moment method, I want now to prove this result of Hara and Sagier. Good, and so what was the statement? So maybe, so recall, this was, I mean, 9.5, this theorem. Let me write it down again. So this was Hara and Sagier from 1986. And there we were looking on the genus expansion of power of traces. So it was, and the genus expansion was given by epsilon gk n to the minus 2g. So this quantity was the expectation of the normalized trace of the 2kth power of our GUE. Okay, and so we know we have this genus expansion, we get some powers of n, and then we count the number of pairings. I mean, a genus expansion is we have to sum over all pairings, and the pairings give a contribution with some power here, and then if we collect the guys which have the same contribution, call this epsilon g of k, then this is the zeroth expansion. The problem is that it's hard to understand those numbers here apart from the trivial case where g is equal to 0. Because this is the leading order term, this is the leading order contribution, which survives if I'm fixing a fixed k. And those are given by the Catalan numbers. They are counting non-crossing pairings. But the subleading orders are not so clear, but Hara and Sagier derived a recursion, and essentially it's a recursion for things which they call bk, and so they are defined by this. So this guy here in leading order is the Catalan number, and then the correction we collect into this multiplicative factor bk. Of course, which depends on n. So maybe I should put an n here, but maybe I leave it out. Good, and then the statement is that there is a recursion between those bk, then we have the recursion for the bk, which connects, maybe I should put an n here, because it really, I'm not changing the n, So this is really saying that the bk plus 1 of n, this is the bk of n, and then I get a k times k plus 1 divided by 4 n squared bk minus 1 for n. So I'm relating the three b's for k plus 1, k, and k minus 1. And this is true for all k greater or equal to 2. Okay, and we saw an example that this seems to be true, but I mean, there's no apparent reason why this should be true. I mean, of course, this is a kind of combinatorial problem. Essentially, I mean, we are counting here elements in a permutation group which satisfy some property. And so you would expect that maybe a simple recursion procedure for counting those guys would give you this, but that's not the case. I mean, there's no clear way of seeing this directly, but there is a more indirect way, and that's what I want to do. And so let us now go in the direction of this. And so let us use some notation. I mean, in particular, this guy here, that's the one in which I'm mostly interested. Let me denote this by T, and it depends on K and on N, of course. I mean, all our quantities depend on K and N. K is the power, which I consider, and N is the size of the matrix. And so I call this E. So this is my normalized trace of AN to the power 2K. So this is just this side. I'm just giving a name to it. And maybe again, let me write down this is by this genus expansion. This is epsilon GK N to the minus 2g. Good. Okay, and now the main, or one of the observations is, I mean, this quantity, somehow, we know somehow how it behaves as if we are fixing k and we consider it in n, because the genus expansion is telling us that actually what we have here is a power series in n. And somehow the main observation is that we should understand it the other way around. What happens if we are fixing n and consider it as a function in k? Okay, so maybe let me first write down. So the genus expansion tells us quite something about a power series in N. If we fix K, the problem only is that we don't really know the coefficients. So we know it's a power series, but we don't have direct access to the coefficients. That's what we want. And actually, we can get access somehow to those numbers if we do things the other way around. Okay, so the genus expansion shows us that this function t, which depends on k and n, is, if we are fixing k, so if we are fixing the power in our trace, so for fixed k, this is a polynomial. Yeah, let's say in n to the minus 1, I have here the negative powers in n, so it's a polynomial in n to the minus 1. Yeah, okay, and now the point is that up to a factor, it's also the other way around. That's a non-trivial observation. That's one of the main observations of Hara and Sagier here. So we will see now that up to let's say, kind of Gaussian factor. It is also a polynomial in K for fixed n. Of course, this is not clear from anything which we have here. And of course, you will get a factorial factor. But apart from this, it will also be a polynomial. Okay, and this polynomial, we will be able to understand much better because essentially, after some remodeling, we can say something about the zeros. So if I have a polynomial, I mean, okay, if I just have an abstract polynomial with some coefficients, okay, I don't know anything. The good thing, which I would like to know are the zeros. If I know sufficiently many zeros of the guy, or let's say I know the zero, if I know the zeros of my polynomial up to its order, then I know more or less the polynomial. Here I have no idea about the zeros of this guy. But if I look the other way around, I will get some idea. It's also non-trivial, but it can be done. Okay, so that's why it is important to also see that it is a polynomial in K. And so that's the main lemma. And this is actually the main place where I'm going to use that this thing is a random matrix object. So Hara and Sagier were not interested in random matrices. They were interested in this formula. I mean, this is a formula. If you take this here, this is counting something in a permutation group. You can forget about random matrices. And they wanted to understand this. This is the modulized space of something. But for this crucial observation, that this is a polynomial in K, they used random matrices. At a time when, in mathematics, more or less nobody knew about random matrices. So I think they had a bit help from the physicists who explained them what you can do with random matrices. And so that's the next lemma, which I want to do now, which shows this statement. And if we have this, then we can start to try, then we know we have a polynomial, and then we can try to understand its zeros and stuff like this. But this statement that it is a polynomial, this is maybe a quite surprising one. So this is the following lemma. So I'm taking this expression, but there will be a factorial factor there, which is of course not a polynomial, but I mean this is something which we can control very nicely. So what I'm looking at is now n to the k, 1 divided by 2k minus 1 double factorial. And this double factorial is the moment of a Gauss variable. And then I take tkn. Okay, so tkn itself is not a polynomial, but it has this double factorial factor. But if I divide this out and also this n to the k, then the claim is this guy is a polynomial of degree. And I also know the degree. So this is a polynomial of degree n minus 1 in k. So if I'm fixing n, then this is a polynomial in k. It has degree n minus 1. Yeah, so let us prove this. And maybe let us see whether at least for small n, one can see it directly. And for n equal to 1, one can see it directly. And there you also see where this guy here comes from. So let us first check the easy thing, easy case. First, the easy case where n is equal to 1. So this means we have a 1 by 1 matrix, which means we just have a Gaussian variable, one variable. And then, of course, so what is then tk of 1? Tk of 1 is now the expectation. But this is a 1 by 1 matrix, so the trace is just a variable. So I'm just taking the 2kth power of a Gaussian variable. And this is just this double factorial. So this is just the 2kth moment of a Gaussian distribution. And this is 2k minus 1 double factorial. Okay, so if n is equal to 1, this term is not here, this is just 1. And then I'm just dividing this guy here, which is this, by this here. So you see I'm just getting 1. So what I consider here, so this is now, okay, let me say this is 1 to the k, tk1 divided by 2k minus 1 double factorial. This is now just 1. And 1, of course, is a polynomial in k, a polynomial of degree 0. And that's exactly what I'm claiming here, because it should be degree n minus 1. If n is 1, degree 0. So this really fits. So this is a polynomial in k of degree 0. Okay, but of course, this is the trivial situation. And it's not obvious, and I mean, even for n equal to 2, you cannot really now calculate things. So it's because you have a 2 by 2 matrix, but you have to look on all powers of it, which is getting quite complicated. So the point is, I mean, it's somehow from the matrix point of view, it's easier to understand if I'm fixing the power but making the matrix bigger and bigger. But if I'm fixing the size of the matrix and making the power bigger and bigger, then it's we'll get very complicated expressions of the entries, which is not so clear how to control them. Good, okay. So, yeah, I mean, we cannot check this now explicitly. We cannot really write down this explicitly. But actually, we know that we have this analytic formula where we can calculate expectations of traces by integrating over the joint eigenvalue distribution. So this means I'm now going from this moment method, this combinatorial method, to this analytic method. That's really the point about random matrices. I can switch between more combinatorial expressions. I'm calculating the traces of a power of the matrix, and then I'm doing it usually in terms of the entries, and the entries are Gaussian distributed, about which I know something. But I can calculate the same object by going over to the eigenvalues and integrating with the eigenvalue expression, for which I have a very analytic expression. And this gives me tools for really observing something like this. If I do here the calculation in terms of the entries, I don't see anything. But if I do it in terms of the eigenvalues, because I have the formula, I will be able to see that it is a polynomial. Yeah, so we should now write down this expectation of the 2kth power of the matrices in terms of the eigenvalue. So we should integrate over our joint eigenvalue density. And this we can do for general n. So for general n, we have the following formula. So let me write down again, tkn. This is by definition taking the expectation of the 2kth power of my n by n matrix. Yeah, okay. And now we know we can get this by doing the integration over the joint eigenvalue distribution. So I get some constant of my probability measure, which only depends on n. So I mean, I have a eigenvalue distribution on n. This doesn't depend on k, so this is only k, and then I'm integrating over r to the n, over my n eigenvalues, and the trace of the 2kth power expressed in the eigenvalues is just the sum over the 2kth power of the eigenvalues. So what I have here is lambda 1 to the 2k plus lambda n to the 2k. Those are my n eigenvalues, and then I have to integrate with respect to the joint eigenvalue distribution, which was given by this density e to the minus trace of a squared, which in terms of the eigenvalues is e to the minus n over 2 lambda 1 squared plus lambda n squared. And then I get the van der Mond determinant, which is given by the product, let's say, I less than j lambda I minus lambda j squared. And I'm integrating over all the lambdas, d lambda 1 up to d lambda n. That's my analytic way of calculating this expectation here. Good. Okay, and now you see what I'm integrating here. So I have here my density, and I'm integrating the sum of all those 2kth power of the lambda 1 up to lambda n. But so I can split this in the sum of integral over lambda 1 to the 2 squared to the 2 power plus the lambda 2 squared and so on. But of course, the distribution of the eigenvalues is symmetric. I have used here the unordered one. So this is symmetric in the lambdas, which means the integral for the lambda 1 to the power 2k is the same as the integral for the lambda 2 to the 2k and so on. So this means I'm just getting here, instead of taking these n terms, I'm just integrating one of them, and then I get this n times, because it's always the same. So this means what I have here is n times cn, and then I'm integrating over r to the n. And let's say I'm taking the first one, lambda 1 to the 2k. And I'm integrating this with respect to e to the minus n over 2 lambda 1 squared plus lambda n squared and so on. The Wandermonde, lambda I minus lambda j squared, I less than j, and integrating over lambda 1 lambda n. Okay, and what I'm interested in is how does this behave on k? And k, I mean, of course, k only shows here up. I mean, it doesn't show up in the density. This is independent of k. So this means the k now only affects the lambda 1, and I can do the integrals over all the other lambdas, lambda 2 up to lambda n. This will give me something which is actually then a polynomial in the lambda 1. So I do the integration over the others, and this does not affect the k, because the k only shows up in the lambda 1 to the 2k. So this means I'm doing the integration over n of n minus 1 of my variables. So I have here n times cn. I mean, those are constants. They depend on n. Dependency on n is okay. It's just what is the dependency on k, which is interesting. So I'm left with the integration over lambda 1. And I have here lambda 1 to the 2k. This was not affected up to now. And then, of course, I get an integral. I get something which depends on the integration over the other variables. And this will be a polynomial in lambda 1. So this will be something which I call Pn of lambda 1. Because you see, I mean, you have here combinations where you have the other lambdas together with the lambda 1. You are integrating out the other lambdas, which gives you a number, but you have a lambda 1 or some factors of lambda 1. So what you get is a polynomial in lambda 1, where I don't know the coefficients, but at least it's a polynomial in lambda 1. And of course, this here is still left. I have integrated out all the other guys, so I still have my density e to the minus n over 2 lambda 1 squared. I have integrated all the other guys here, so I'm just left with integration over lambda 1. So where the Pn, where Pn of lambda 1 is the result of integrating. And what have I integrated? Essentially, I mean, I have integrated the Wandermonde here with respect to this density here. So I have the integrating the Wandermonde over the eigenvalues lambda 2 up to lambda n. Okay, and so what can we say about the Pn of lambda 1? So this is, first of all, it's an even polynomial. Is this clear? Let's see. So why is this even? Because I mean, I get here products of lambda 1 and the other lambdas, which I'm integrating. And if lambda 1 appears an odd number of times, then also one of the other must appear an odd number of times. But a Gaussian moment of something which an odd moment is zero. So the only moments which give something means the other lambdas over which I integrate must appear an even number of times, which means the lambda 1 over which I'm not integrating must also appear an even number of times. Or maybe this was nonsense. It's just because I have the square here. So you see, I mean, I have always the square of lambda 1. No, this is nonsense. I think the previous explanation was the correct one. Because, for example, I mean, I have lambda 1 minus lambda 2. I take the square of this and I integrate over this, which means, of course, I have the lambda 1 squared. I have minus 2 times lambda 1, lambda 2, plus lambda 2 squared. And so I'm integrating this here over lambda 2. This will just give a constant. And this term, which would be odd in lambda 1, this goes away because the integral over lambda 2 is 0. Because this is odd. And I'm integrating with respect to this symmetric density, with respect to the Gauss distribution, which means odd moments are all 0. So this means all the terms which I'm multiplying out here, which have an odd number of lambda ones, also have an odd number of at least one of the other lambda over integrate. So these terms vanish. Good, okay, so I think we have a kind of explanation why Pn of lambda 1 is an even polynomial, and maybe we should think about the degree, because we are interested in degrees. So what is the maximal degree? So Pn of lambda 1 is an even polynomial in lambda 1. And what is the maximal degree? The degree, yeah, so what is the maximal number of lambda ones which I can get if I multiply this out? This is of course, so I have here a term lambda 1 minus some of the other lambdas. Okay, so I have lambda 1 minus lambda 2, lambda 1 minus lambda 3. So this means I have n minus 1 terms, vectors. Because I have it squared, so I have here 2n minus 1 vectors, where each of them contains a lambda 1. So the maximal degree which I can get for lambda 1 is 2 times n minus 1. Which means if I'm taking always the lambda 1 out of those differences. So it has degree 2 times n minus 1. And of course, this will be a polynomial where the coefficients will depend on n, but not on k. This is an integration here where I'm integrating over my Gaussian on n times n matrices. So the result, of course, will depend on n, but it doesn't depend on k. So k is still just here. So the coefficients here depend only on n, and we don't really know how they depend on n, but this will not be really important, not on k. Yeah, so this means I can, maybe let me write my Pn of lambda 1 as formal polynomial, so it's a sum from 0 to n minus 1. I have some coefficients, alpha n, and then I have lambda 1 to the power 2l. So it has to be even, so it's 2l, and the maximal degree is 2 times n minus 1. And here I just have some coefficients, which I don't know, which might depend on n, but not on k. Can depend on n. This whole thing has nothing to do with k. Yeah, good. But now, of course, I should do the final integration over lambda 1, and this depends then, of course, somehow on k. Yeah, so let us do this. But this is now just a Gaussian integral over some polynomial in lambda 1. So I'm integrating now over lambda 1 with respect to the Gauss distribution, and I'm taking just a polynomial, which means I'm just integrating over a linear combination of moments. And of course, the moments of a Gauss I know. So what we get is now that the TKn, so I continue this here. So here, I'm still here. So I have n times Cn, just some constants. Then I'm writing down now explicitly my Pn. So this is the sum from L0 to n minus 1 of, I have alpha L. And then it's a P1 to some power, but I have to do the integration. So here I should do my integration. And I have now lambda 1. But lambda 1 I have now from here is a power 2k. And I also have it somehow here coming from this polynomial. So I have now to the power 2k plus 2l. And the density, which I'm still am left with, is minus n over 2 times lambda 1 squared. I'm integrating with respect to this. Okay, and now this, so now you see, for each fixed L, this is just a moment of a Gaussian variable, and we know the moments of this. Yeah, of course, I mean there are some constants here, but they don't depend on k. Yeah, so what I get here, this integration here is okay, some normalization constant which depends on n, and then it's the 2k plus 2l moment of a Gaussian, which is given by 2k plus 2l minus 1, and then a double factorial. Oh, that's the moments of the Gauss. And yeah, actually, because I have here the n, I have to do a change of variable, I also get a n to the minus k. Oh, okay, so this is the 2nth moment of a Gauss of variance n to the minus 1. Yeah, and so we see now, you see we have these double factorials. I mean, double factorials are not polynomial. No? I mean, if k is involved, if k is getting bigger and bigger, I'm multiplying more and more terms, this is not polynomial. So we should somehow get rid of this. And of course, I also have this n to the minus k here, which I also bring on the other side. But that was in my lemma, that was the reason I took this out, the n to the k. So what I have now is n to the k, and then I take the t kn, but double factorials, they are there, but I just can get rid of them by just dividing by the 2k minus 1 double factorial, just by this one here. And then what is this? So you see, this here goes away, and essentially I'm getting the sum over some coefficients, and then I'm getting this divided by this, so this is now a linear combination. Where the coefficients, of course, depend on n of terms of the form. And of course, what I'm interested in is what are the terms containing k. And this is, okay, maybe I shouldn't have called this kn. This is just a constant. So this is not the k here. This is just some other constant. So the k is showing up here. I mean, this I have brought on the other side and here. So I have a linear combination of terms of the form I just have this 2k plus 2l, so this was 2k plus 2l, and then minus 1 double factorial. So I have 2k plus 2l minus 1 double factorial divided by 2k minus 1 double factorial. Okay, and so what is this? This is now a polynomial in k of degree l. So you see, I mean, I'm starting here at 2k plus 2l minus 1. I'm going down in steps of 2, but as soon as I hit this one, it will be cancelled away. So I just have here L factors, which are remaining. So this here is a factorial, or double factorial. It's not a polynomial, but if I divide two of them in this way, such that I only remain with a fixed number of terms, which don't depend on k, but only on L, then of course I have a polynomial. So this is a polynomial in k of degree L. And so I get here a linear combination where L is running from 0 to n minus 1. So I get here a combination of polynomials in k which are of degree L. So the highest degree which I get is 2n minus 1. And this is exactly my statement. So this this gives a surgeon. Okay, and that's the proof of this lemma. So you see, I mean, we have coefficients depending on n, which we have no idea about, but that's not the important thing. The important thing is we can control what happens in k. So we have here a polynomial in k after dividing by those terms which we have explicitly. Yeah, and this will now, I mean, this is not a starting point of the proof. I mean, we still have to do quite a few things, but what we are going to do now is essentially combinatorics. So this was really the part where we used analysis and in particular random matrix interpretation of this thing here. But random matrix interpretation in a way that we had an analytic formula for calculating this, which gives us this lemma. Okay, and now next time we can now try to understand this polynomial. The idea would of course be to see what are the zeros of this polynomial. But of this polynomial we cannot do this, but we can change it in a form where we can control this polynomial. So this will still be a nice combinatorial exercise, which I will do next time. Good, thank you.